Today, we're going to resurrect a 10-year-old server, the venerable Acer Aspire Easystore H340 home server that runs on a vintage Intel Atom processor. Carbon dating indicates that I purchased it in December of 2009, and I shut it down and placed it in storage about 7 years ago after the hard drive containing the operating system failed. What I plan to do is not only boot into Windows 10 Professional on a flash drive, but install 4 5-terabyte disks, giving me a total of 20 terabytes to play with. To use the server today, the problems are numerous. Out of the box, the server runs headless, which means that it doesn't have any monitor output. So normally, you have to install, maintain, and monitor the server remotely using these CDs on another computer on the network. Though the unit can hold 4 SATA hard drives, it requires the operating system to be installed on the first drive, which means that you share your storage with Windows. If it fails, as it did in my case, the entire system goes down. Finally, the operating system is Windows Home Server, which is based on the old Windows Server 2003 R2. Unfortunately, that version could only support hard drives up to 2 terabytes in size, so the entire server could only support a maximum of 8 terabytes. But remember, that number isn't a hardware limitation, it's a software limitation of Windows Home Server. To overcome these problems, I'm going to install Windows 10 Pro on a USB drive. That gives me the entire space of all 4 disks to use as storage, and I don't have to share disk 1 with the operating system. I plan to install a low-profile ATI FireMV 2250 video card, which I picked up on eBay for around $11. Eventually, I'll remote into the machine to maintain it, but while I'm accessing the BIOS and installing Windows 10 Professional, I want to see what I'm doing. On the back of this particular video card, it has a DMS59 adapter. It kind of looks like a DVI port from a distance, but you can see that it's much more dense than a DVI. The adapter I'm using is a leftover from an old Dell server, and it has a DMS59 connector on one end and 2 DVI connectors on the other. If you're following along in this video to retrofit your Acer server, some other items you'll need are a Phillips head screwdriver, an ESD wrist strap to prevent any static damage, and a jumper that connects 2 pins together on the motherboard. You may also want to grab some tweezers like the one I have here to help install the jumper. You'll also need a Windows 10 ISO file, the specifics of which I'll cover a little later. Before we dismantle the unit, let's go over some of the features of the hardware. As I mentioned before, it's powered by an Atom 230 processor. As far as speed is concerned, all I care about is whether it has the horsepower to serve files, since I'm going to be using it to feed my Plex Media server. Scoring a whopping 210 passmark, it'll nevertheless be more than fast enough for my purposes. And as a bonus, the processor consumes very little power with a TDP of only 4 watts. It comes with 2 GB of memory, and as we scan the rear of the unit, we have a gigabit Ethernet port along with 4 USB 2 ports and even an eSATA port. At the front, we have another USB 2 port along with a door that reveals 4 3.5-inch drive bays. What you'll want to do first is unfasten these 3 screws in the back. We can then remove the cover. In order to access the BIOS, you'll need to cover 2 jumper pins on the motherboard. Let's rotate the case to the side that has the small PCIe slot. Before we start, I'll put on my ESD strap around my wrist and connect it to the metal part of the case. As we peer inside, you'll see the 2 pins right here. Taking some tweezers, I'll grab a jumper and carefully, gracefully, delicately place it on the 2 pins. Next, let's prepare for installing the graphics card in the PCIe slot. After turning the case a little bit, I'll first remove this screw in the back and swivel the cover from the opening. Then remove the backplate. Next, let's return the case to face the side and take a look at the ATI FireMV 2250 graphics card. We'll need to match up its connector to the PCIe slot on the motherboard. The main thing to look for is this angled metal corner because it obstructs the card from going in. It'll be a tight fit, so you'll need to adjust some of the bundles of cables as I show here, and then angle the card in. Once it's sitting firmly in the PCIe slot, let's rotate the case again, swivel the cover back on, and secure everything with a screw in the back, and then we're done. While unclipping the ESD strap, I'll turn the case to face the rear, where we can then return the case cover and screw everything back on. I'll also take the DMS59 to DVI adapter and connect it to the output of the graphics card, so we can be ready to hook it up to a monitor when the time comes to turn it on. The next step is to create a bootable Windows media using this USB thumb drive. You'll want to create it on another computer or laptop, so let's plug it into this USB port. You'll then want to launch your favorite browser in order to search for Rufus, spelled R-U-F-U-S. After opening the first link that's returned in the search results, scroll down a bit until you reach the download section, then select the latest release. We'll save the file, after which we'll open the folder location and double-click the executable to launch the program. By default, the device will be set to your USB thumb drive. In the next field, you select the Windows 10 ISO file that you want to install on the thumb drive, but there are some caveats. I've already prepared a couple ISO files to show you what I mean. In my Documents folder, I have two official and legitimate ISO files downloaded directly from Microsoft's Azure Education Program, which are for builds 1809 and 2004. There's a bug. Not in Rufus, but in the 1809 build of Windows 10, which causes blue screen crashes when attempting to boot off a USB drive. In fact, if I choose the 1809 ISO and attempt to start the process by selecting the Windows to Go image option and choosing the Professional Edition of Windows 10, Rufus will give me a warning about the bug. Because of that, you'll want to choose any build but 1809, such as 1803, 1903, or 2004, which I'll select right now. You'll want to make sure the Windows to Go option is selected as the image option. I'll switch to the MBR partition scheme and the target system as BIOS or UEFI, accept all the other defaults, then hit the Start button. In this particular image, I'm prompted to choose the edition of Windows 10 that matches my license, so I'll choose Windows 10 Professional. Notice that the 1809 bug warning doesn't appear, but it does warn me that any data that exists on the USB drive will be wiped out. And since I don't have anything important on it, I'll click OK and continue. The creation of the bootable USB disk will take some time, so I'll throw a turkey pot pie in the toaster oven and I'll be right back. Okay, I'm back. Now that Rufus is done with the USB disk, we can close out of it. Let's go ahead and eject the USB drive from Windows by right-clicking it and selecting Eject. We can now physically remove it from the laptop and then shift it over to the server, where I'll insert it into a USB port there. We now have to make sure we have all the cables we need to power it up, including the power cord, the DVI cable to the monitor, a mouse and keyboard, where I'll plug the USB receiver for the wireless mouse to the wired keyboard, which then plugs into a USB port, and finally, a network cable that plugs into the gigabit Ethernet port. Without any hard drives in any of the four drive bays, let's power up the system. If you're curious about the power consumption of the unit, I've attached the power cord to a kilowatt meter, which shows that it ramps up to about 33 watts as it powers up. When the POST screen appears on the monitor, press F2 immediately in order to enter the BIOS. Note that if we hadn't inserted the jumper on the motherboard, you wouldn't have been able to access this screen at all. Moving to the main menu, you can see that the four SATA ports are empty, and navigating to the boot screen shows the boot order, where our USB thumb drive appears as a choice. Curiously, you'll also see another USB entry, the SMI USB disk, which is 256 megabytes in size. This is actually a small storage space that's included on the mainboard of the server, which holds the installation files for Windows Home Server. If it had been larger, we might have been able to install Windows 10 onto it and boot it from there. As it happens, others have been able to install FreeNAS in this small space. What you'll want to do is disable this boot device, because we never want Windows Home Server to start its installation process. According to the instructions on the right side, we need to hit Shift 1 to disable a device, which places an exclamation mark in front of it. make sure that our USB thumb drive is the first device in the list, after which we can move to the exit screen and save our changes. After viewing the post screen again, and after an agonizing few seconds, you should see the Windows logo, which indicates that the Windows to Go installation is starting. Eventually, you'll be presented with the Windows Setup Wizard. Now, it's just a matter of going through the motions of installing Windows 10 Pro on a very slow Atom processor, including the acceptance of terms, rebooting, waiting, and rebooting, and waiting. I'll throw a whole turkey in the toaster oven and come back when it's done. Okay, we're now in a freshly installed Windows 10 environment. The next step is to install the four hard drives. Each drive bay is hot swappable, but I'm going to shut down the computer anyways. The bays correspond to disks 0, 1, 2, and 3. I'm going to take out all the trays so we can mount the disks in them. Let's start with the bottom tray. Since it's a toolless caddy, what you'll want to do is align the pins of the tray with the holes on the disk. Start with this left side first, and then bend the flexible right side to insert its pins into the right side of the hard drive. We can now return the tray to its drive bay, and once we have the other disks mounted in their trays, we can insert the others. Afterwards, let's start up the server again. Checking the kilowatt meter with all four disks installed, we see it spike to as high as 90 watts before it drops to a steady state of about 51 or 52. After booting into Windows, I'd like to first prepare the server for remote access, after which I'll configure the disks. Let's go to the search bar and type Allow, which should return a link to allow remote access to this computer. Click on that link, which will launch the Settings app, taking us directly to the remote desktop settings. Please note that this is a feature of Windows 10 Professional, and you won't have this ability if you have the Home Edition. Under that section, hit the Show Setting link next to the first checkbox label, which pops up a dialog box where we can select Allow Remote Connections to this computer, then click OK. You can always use the host name to remote into the server, but I like to assign static IP addresses to my computers. Let's right-click the network icon in the taskbar and choose Open Network and Network Settings. There's more than one way to assign a static IP address, but I usually go through the Network and Sharing Center, after which I click My Ethernet Connection, click its Properties button, select TCP/IP v4, and hit Properties, where I can set an IP address. I'll assign one that isn't in my DHCP pool, let's say .99, then fill out all the other information, including the subnet mask, default gateway, and DNS server. We can now click OK, close out of Ethernet Properties, then close the dialog box. Now let's go back to the laptop, which is on the same network as the server. Hit the Start menu and type Remote, which should return Remote Desktop Connection as the first choice. Type the computer's name or the IP address of the server. In my case, as you may recall, it's the static IP of 192.168.1.99. After hitting Connect, then entering the username and password, and waiting a few moments for the connection to be established to the server, you should now be able to see the server's desktop in the resolution of your laptop's monitor. From here, I'll configure the hard drives. We can either use the disks individually by initializing them in Disk Management, where you can see the four hard drives appear in their uninitialized states as disks 0 through 3, or we can take advantage of Microsoft's storage pools and storage spaces. For instance, if I wanted to have two storage pools, each one having a set of mirrored drives, I could hit the search bar and then type storage spaces. Click the returned result, where you can then create a new storage pool using the hard drives we've just inserted. Since a mirror requires two disks, let's choose disks 0 and 1 by deselecting 2 and 3. After it creates the pool, I can name the storage space. Let's call it Data 01. Virtually, those two physical disks will be assigned the letter F. I'll select a two-way mirror, but you can experiment with three-way mirror where you need at least three drives, or parity, which closely resembles RAID 5 or 6. We'll keep the size at its maximum of 5 terabytes and create the storage space. But that's only one storage pool. To make another set of mirror discs, we can create another pool by clicking the link on the left, where I'll keep the selections of discs 2 and 3 to generate the pool. Then we'll call this mirrored storage space Data 02, giving me a disk G when all is said and done. Next, we'll want to share the F and G drives so that other computers on the network can access them. After closing out storage spaces, I'll launch File Explorer, where I can see the two mirrored spaces we just created, each one having a capacity of 5 terabytes. Incidentally, notice that the C drive is actually the USB flash drive, which includes the e-boot partition created by Rufus, while D is the 256-megabyte onboard USB device. By right-clicking F, I can go to its properties and the Sharing tab to enable and define the name of the share, limit the number of users, and optionally, assign the users who can access the share. After closing out of the dialog boxes for the first drive, I'll do the same thing for the G drive by again launching its properties, navigating to the Sharing tab, where I'll just leave everything on default in the Advanced Sharing section for the purposes of this video. Remember, all this time we've been on the laptop connecting remotely into the server. I'll now minimize the remote desktop session to return to the laptop. Let's start File Explorer on the laptop, where I'll try to access the shared drives on the server. Let's type /192.168.1.99, which brings up the shared folders for which I have at least read-only access. I just had some final notes on some minor problems that I encountered with this project. The blue lights that indicate the existence of a hard drive in each bay didn't light up. In addition, I found that the information icon on the front panel kept blinking, but I'm keeping it in a closet in the basement, so that doesn't bother me too much. Also note that because of the Atom CPU, things may run slowly when you remote into it, but I've experienced no slowness in file transfers, with speeds reaching close to what you'd expect from a gigabit connection. I now use the server without a monitor, knowing that I can attach one at any time in case something goes wrong with remote access. I hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching.